not. Well, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 6. Let me tell you the lesson that I have. And I am so thankful, I'm so grateful to be able to present this lesson. When it first went out, I think it was the morning after, I texted David and I said, is it too late to get the gospel of peace for the adults? And he says, no, you got it. And I got the helmet of salvation last night with the teenagers, and that was exactly what I was wanting. Ephesians 6 and verse 15 is our main verse, but let's begin reading with verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day. And having done all to stand, stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. We're going to come back to that verse. Above all, take the shield of faith, with which you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to the end with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints. I volunteered for this one. This was the one that I wanted to do. I could hide it with the best of you. I knew how to come to church, having been overwhelmed with whatever I was having to deal with, and being asked, how you doing? And you know what the answer would be, don't you? Fine, that's it. Until I couldn't do it anymore. I knew the key verses about peace. Philippians 4, verse 7, a beautiful verse. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. John 14 and verse 7, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give to you, let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. And then John 16 and verse 33, and I was just thinking about this verse just this morning again. Jesus says, these things I have spoken to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. I think years ago I misunderstood that verse. I thought that it meant, you know, either you're going to have tribulation or you can have peace. But that's not what that verse means. Jesus is giving us a peace that we can have while we undergo tribulation. And that's pretty significant. Don't misunderstand me. I experienced the peace of God when he led me. And I went back to Psalm 23, in green pastures beside still waters. It's easy to have peace then. Everything is fine. There's no issues. There's no tribulation. But how do you have peace in the valley of the shadow of death. Is it possible to have peace when you are eating your meals in the presence of your enemies, as he says later on in that great psalm? I chose this topic because I struggled to have peace. Maybe that's not anything that you knew about me, but I struggled to have the peace of God. How does that relate to our being a good soldier? You will want, if you don't have the peace of God, you will want to do your soldiering, not in any field that God would send you to, but you would want to remain, and you would have that peace as long as you were allowed by God to be in green pastures beside still waters. But God does not keep us there. How do you have peace when you go to other places? I had to do 4 things to get this peace. I want to tell you what those 4 things were. First of all, I had to deal with my own anger. For me to have peace, I had to learn to deal with my anger, resentment, and hostility. I'm still dealing with it. One of Satan's fiery darts says, "You have a right to be angry." And you know that may be true, but not if it takes away God's peace. I don't know many people who grew up learning how to deal with anger. I know that my child did not, because I couldn't teach her. I didn't know how to myself. So how could she grow up knowing how to deal with anger? Another one of Satan's fiery darts is, you should never be angry. I didn't have to deal with that one too long. I knew I was angry at times. But I mention it because you may have to deal with that dart. Satan may be telling you that it's not right for you to be angry. Another dart that I did deal with of Satan's was, you should never express your anger. Now, I did deal with that. I have dealt with that one. That dart hit me. I tried different things. I tried suppressing my anger. But you know what happened, don't you? I exploded. That's what happens when you suppress it. I tried not voicing my anger. And although that helps with some anger, that's not a good way of dealing with all anger. I tried voicing the anger to the one with whom I was angry. And that didn't always work well either, because you have no control how the other person is going to respond to your voicing of that anger. So what helped? What helped me was I tried talking to the Lord about the anger, and I found that that really helps. I think that Moses, in Numbers, the 20th chapter, you remember when he commits his great sin? He gets fed up with the people. God tells him to speak to the rock, and what does he do? He strikes the rock. And not only does he strike the rock, but he doesn't speak to the rock. He speaks to the people and tells them, we have taken you out. And Moses wasn't the lead. God was the one that was leading the children of Israel. He got it all wrong. And because of that, he suffered the punishment, the consequence of not being able to go into the promised land. But I understand him being upset, don't you? I understand him being frustrated because I've been there before. I've been that one, like Moses, and just lost it all. Israel just kept on murmuring and complaining. And Moses finally had enough. I found talking to a brother will help. But I have to tell you, you have to be careful with this one, because you don't need someone to just say, yeah, I know what you need someone that'll hold you accountable. You don't need someone to tell you, yeah, you're right. You need someone that will tell you you're wrong or get this straightened out. I tried journaling. And a journal, to me, is just a prayer to God that's being written out. And that has helped. In fact, just recently, I was dealing with some anger around the time of my father's death. And I did not know why. I did not know what was at the root of that anger. And I sat down one morning. Yeah, it was morning. It was about 1 o'clock that morning, because I couldn't go to sleep. I sat down at my computer and I started writing. About an hour and a half later, it became apparent what the issue was. You see, journaling for me helped me to put it in perspective. It helped me to look at it in a different way. Whatever you do, be brutally honest about your anger. You don't get over anger by trying to convince someone that you're right. Tell people the truth. And a lot of times that will help get things right. So first of all, I had to deal with my anger. Still dealing with my anger. It's not something that I have totally right yet. I think that I'll be dealing with anger until the day that I die. But I'm dealing with it, and I want to deal with it. Second, realize that you don't control your circumstances. That seems pretty simple, but that's hard to do. The longer you allow God to lead you, the more you will be led into circumstances beyond your control. I used to think that I controlled much more than I do. I came to realize, and it took years for me to realize, that I control my words, my actions, my thoughts, my motives, and that's about it. Not much more than that. I started coming to that realization, sitting in a counselor's office, talking with him And then I went to some Al-Anon meetings. And it became even clearer to me. I want to ask y'all, are y'all familiar with the serenity prayer? God, grant me the serenity to accept the things that I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. That prayer, when it is prayed, not just as a prayer of memorization, but when it is honestly and from the heart prayed, is a very powerful prayer. You come to the realization that you don't control a lot of things. The things that you do control, your words, your actions, your thoughts, your motives, that's a full-time job right there, dealing with those instead of other things. One of Satan's darts. So you're in control of everything. You ever known somebody that tried to control everything? It's hard. It is hard being that kind of person, but the scripture says, by the grace of God, I am what I am. I went to counseling. I sat in Al-Anon meetings. I know tribulation. John 16, verse 33, Jesus says that we're going to have tribulation. I know the turmoil of having a loved one struggle with alcohol and drugs. I know the long-lasting effects of troubled marriages, divorces, and remarriage. I've experienced the devastating effect of suicide. I know the problems that come from mental illness. And I don't think that my circumstances are probably any different from any of the circumstances that you would have in your life. My point is not that my circumstances are more severe. I'm telling you that those are things that I wouldn't wish on my enemy. But you can experience God's peace because it is a gift in spite of those circumstances. I know because I do. And I can tell you something else. You can lose the peace of God for circumstances that are less than that. I know. I have. Some people wonder, the peace of God, you should not experience, and this is the way that some people may think, might be the way that you think. You should not experience the peace of God in these kind of circumstances. Oh, but you can. It's not a peace that no longer cares. I was thinking about that aspect. Just because I care about you and you're going through something that is bigger than what I have ever faced, doesn't mean that I'd lose my peace. Jesus, we're told to cast all of our cares upon him because he cares for us, aren't we? 1 Peter 5 and verse 7. Does that cause Jesus to lose any peace? No. Jesus still is the Prince of Peace, even when we cast all of our cares on him. You see, his peace is not diminished when you follow that verse. You're not hurting Jesus. He hurts for you, but he still has the peace of God. Some might think, and this is a lie of Satan, one of those fiery darts, if you really cared, you would not experience God's peace. Some people might want you to get in an uproar and be all troubled when they share with you their circumstances. And I want to tell you that the loving thing to do is to let them know that God loves them, God cares for them, and God is greater than any of those circumstances that they're facing. And God can see them through. This is not a peace that denies reality. It's a peace, as we said in Philippians 4, that surpasses all understanding. I don't know how you can have this peace. I don't understand how you have that peace, but you can have it, even in spite of your circumstances. It's not based upon your circumstances. If you could control your circumstances, would you put yourself in the situation that most people wouldn't? Notice 2 Corinthians 8. The amazing grace of Jesus. Second Corinthians 8 and verse 9. That's 1 Corinthians. Let's go to 2 Corinthians, just a moment. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you through his poverty might become rich. You know something, I would not choose the circumstances that I have had to face at times. Maybe you wouldn't. But Jesus did. Isn't that amazing? Jesus chose his circumstances. He chose the cross. He chose the tribulation. Third point, third thing that I did, do what is right. That sounds simple, but I want to clarify some things here. We never earn our peace. It is a gift from God. Yet one of the conditions of peace from God is living in communion with God. Living in fellowship with God. When there is a direct command of God, obey it. Do what the Bible says. He is the God of peace. Don't have a confrontation with God in words or your actions. Live at peace with God. One of Satan's darts, fiery darts, says, you don't have to obey God. You can obey God later. You can obey God when it really makes a difference in your life. And you may think that the situation that you're in doesn't call for obedience. And I want to tell you that there's enough questions about things to do, and we're going to talk about that here in just a moment. But when it comes to a command of God, do it. When he says to do something, when he says to believe, when he says to repent, when he says to be baptized, do it. Don't say but. Don't bring up objections. Obey God. Why? How does that have something to do with peace? There's going to be enough questions about other things that you want to make sure that when there's no question about it, you're doing what you need to do. When you know that the Lord wants you here and worshiping with the saints, be here. It's not up for debate. Just do what God says. Because there are so many questions. And sometimes those questions can rob us of that peace. There's 1,000 questions that we face. Am I going to the right school? Am I in the right career? The one right now for me is it time for me to stop working? I don't know the answer to that yet. But I know I'm going to do what's right. You see, while I'm still mulling around and asking myself the answer to these other questions, there is the tendency to think, well, my answer to those questions determines whether I have peace or not. No, they don't. The answer to your peace is to obey God. Those questions, though they are important, are significant, but they do not control whether you have the peace of God or not. The peace of God is going to come when you put first God's kingdom. And when you are do right, when it's clear to do what is right. Jesus said in the Sermon on the Mount, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. He'll take care of you. No matter what that means, he'll take care of you. That's Matthew 6:33. Finally, fourth, fight for peace. Fight for peace. And that might sound like a contradiction of terms. How can you have peace and be fighting at the same time? But I've come to realize that I can't take God's peace for granted. I must keep dealing with anger. I must remind myself that I don't control my circumstances. I have to remind myself of that quite often. And I must keep doing what is right. You see, if I'm going to be a good soldier of Jesus, there is preparation, and that's the way that that this verse puts it. Did you notice that? Go back to Ephesians 6. And having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. You get this right. You have the peace of God, and that prepares you to go out and be a good soldier. This is basic training. Get your gear right. Get your mind right so that you can go out and be a good soldier. Because if you don't, you can't. You see, I have to make sure that my feet are shod with the gospel of peace. That's the most difficult one of these for me. I'm going to have to spend more time and be more deliberate about this one than any of these others. That's why I want to talk about this one. Because I can tell you that being a soldier involves a lot of different duties and a lot of different abilities. A lot of training. Some of it will come easy. Some of it won't. What is easy for me may not be easy for you. What is difficult for me may be easy for you. But I can tell you without a shadow of a doubt that whatever your struggle is in being a soldier of the cross of Christ, whatever that is, he just told me 5 minutes. Finished up good, didn't we? Whatever it is, it's worth getting it right so that you can be a good soldier of the cross. Let's get your songbooks. Turn to number 390. I want to sing a couple of the verses of this song. 390. 390. The storm in this song is anything that would cause peace to not be in your life. You're going to have periods of calm. You'll have periods of storm, of tribulation. The first verse, we recognize that. Notice the second verse. We're going to sing the second verse too. One of the things that I did with my lesson is I talked about some of the fiery darts that will take that away. The second verse is talking about fiery darts, isn't it? Many times Satan whispered, it's a fiery dart. Whatever would cause you, prevent you from being a good soldier, take care of it. And sing this song. In the dark of the midnight, have I all hid my face while the storms howl above me and there's no hiding place. In the crash of the thunder, precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe. Thank you. And I apologize for being late. If y'all had started at 7 o'clock, I'd have been here in plenty of time.